Welcome back, everybody! I'm here with some more I Played a Thing, Dark Souls 2, Scholar of the First Sin. I am back. It's good to be home, good to sleep in my own bed again. I would like to thank everybody who wished me a happy Dicks-in-a-Row birthday, and all you folks who bid me good travels. And they were good travels, thank you. Why am I going back this way? I can just warp to my last bonfire. Anyway, so yeah, good travels. I'm a little bit tired, got home fairly late last night, and a little bit congested. I may have picked up a little crud in my travels. Hopefully that will pass without too much lingering or too much worsening. But yeah, it's good to be back. Last time, you may recall, we met most of the folks in Majula, and made our early incursions into the Forest of Fallen Giants. And today we don't have too many folks to have lengthy dialogues with, so we can just get right back into the Forest of Fallen Giants and probably complete most of the area today, I'm hoping. Oh, you just flail away as much as you want. Again, I have no particular desire to mess with the hippo over there. I don't believe there are any notable rewards for it. So, I'm perfectly happy to just leave it alone. And because it has a nice wide aggro radius, I'm not terribly likely to piss it off unintentionally. Ooh, had my guard broken by an arrow there, and had my face nearly broken by an axe. Taking a few hits there, gotta be a little more careful. I do have a little rust on me, I will admit. As for the last week and change, I have not only not been playing this, I have not been playing any of the video games at all. So please bear with me as I shake off the cobwebs, both from my travels and from my general, brief hiatus from gaming. And as always, any corpse that resembles a standard enemy model should be viewed with extreme suspicion. Now, those of you who are veterans of Dark Souls 2 and not so familiar with Scholar of the First Sin may notice something missing here. Usually there would be a Haid Knight ahead, who was non-aggressive, wouldn't mess with you unless you messed with him, but you could beat him up and possibly get a good weapon out of the bargain. He's not here now, there are just a lot more of these hollow infantry-type guys kicking around. And just in the interest of thoroughness and getting myself some souls, I'm going to want to take them all out, but we should be able to avoid annoying too many of them at one time. Oh, and there's a guy up there who I think has a bow, so we'll want to be careful about him as well. Yeah, all of these duders around here are gonna wake up when I get close enough to attract their attention, but we can do that gradually, and it's a very good idea to do so. I'm not sure how easy it is to attract the attention of the projectile guy up there, so I'm just gonna be wary of him. I did have a recent practice run, but as this is a rather lengthy game, I'm a little bit rusty on the Forest of Fallen Giants in particular, being as it is typically the first area and all. And absolutely nothing rebounds off this starting shield. That feels awkward to me. I definitely look forward to getting a better portable wall for myself. (Risa) Part of the trickiness here is I'm not sure which guys I haven't activated yet and which ones I've already killed. Just really not in love with this, Morningstar's moveset. Well, that's another thing I'll definitely be looking forward to, is getting a weapon that somewhat more suits my style. Can't complain too much about the performance of this one, but I'm just not crazy about the way it feels. Not great range on it either. Maybe that guy up there doesn't have a bow at all. I don't remember reliably. With as deeply in love as Dark Souls 2 is with its snipers, you would think so, but maybe not. Nah, human effigy, that's good stuff. Oh, is that a firebomb? That may be what he has rather than a bow. Firebomber's not quite so common in this game, but certainly there are those around as well. Yep, that's what he's doing. Okay. At least I know he can't hit me from real far away. That's good to know. Whoa, far enough. I'll be going up there in a moment, but... Oh, hey, I missed you. I'll take care of that quickly enough. Anyway, as I was saying, I will be going upward again in a moment rather than going through the fog gate. But I saw a sconce. And as I've mentioned, I'm a little obsessive-compulsive about those. I cannot see a sconce and not light it. So give me just a second to dash on back to the bonfire here. I will spark up my torch and we will get that squared away. Man, I've only got a little more than a minute left on my torch. That's a little bit unsettling, but we'll get that taken care of. In the early game, torch time is in rather short supply, but we will be getting more than we know what to do with by the end. At least that is my standard experience. I'm sure the game will find some way to make a liar out of me, as it's so good at doing. Alright, well that's that one taken care of anyway. Over there, it is possible to jump off of this this drop here. Hang on, I'm going to adjust my chair a little bit. There, hopefully I sound a little clearer now. So yeah, we could make that jump over yonder, but I think there's nothing real exciting on that corpse, just maybe a couple life gems or something. And if I miss the jump, I will most likely die of the fall, so screw it. Oh, hi, guy. No, you don't get to kick me in the head. I get to bash you in the head. I get to miss bashing you in the head. Alright, I get to smash your spine in. That's good enough. Alright, is there anything back here I do not recall reliably? Yes, yes there is. A minor consumable, nothing exciting, but worth having. Especially when we have so few souls and it takes so few to get us a level up. This guy might try and kind of pop me in the face with a firebomb as I approach. I'm going to want to be wary of that. As Sonic would say, you're too slow. And it looks like we've got another treasure over there, just on the other side of this gap, so try jumping? Good idea. Ah, a short sword. That will almost certainly be a better backup weapon than the broken sword that I currently have. Yep, very nice indeed. And seeing as I've already got less than half of the durability on my Morningstar, it's good to have a competent backup weapon. Again, weapon durability is a much greater concern in this game than it was in the original Dark Souls. Your stuff wears out kind of quick. But on the bright side, you can always repair just by stopping by a bonfire. And that's usually what you'll have to do, because there is repair powder in this game, but it is much harder to come by, and you will not have a reliable source of it for quite some time. Actually, let's compare here. That's 100 plus 45, that's 110 plus 34 with some bleed. Onward through the fog. Yep, there's gonna be a duder around the corner there. We could go through this way, but I'll take the long way around just to make sure we get rid of everybody. Hey, buddy. Come on out. Let me funnel you into a nice little death corridor here. There we go. And what did you drop for me? Some boots. Anybody else around here? No? Good. Oh, actually, yes. You don't even have a weapon. I'm gonna break your furniture. And get some bolts. Well, that'll be nice to have when I have something to fire them with. Crossbows are actually a good deal more useful in this game than they were in Dark Souls 1, because if you two-hand them, you can aim them. These sword-heaven buddies are a little more dangerous than their foot-soldier brethren, but still entirely manageable. God, my stamina is so bad at this point in the game, though. That's something we're going to want to level up as a major priority. Alright, took a minor spanking there. Nothing we can't heal up from readily enough, though. Yeah, enemy to the right, we already saw that. I didn't actually pick up a crossbow at any point, did I? No, not yet. That's fine. Free healing is good. Tight spot ahead, therefore try thrust. Sorry, message writer, I'm not so much into the necrophilia thing. Yep, they shooting. That guy up there, I don't trust him. Do we have any throwing knives or anything? Nope, jack and shit. Okay, so we'll just do this the hard way. Can you see me there? He did. Oh, he's gonna try and firebomb. Alright, and we'll take out his bow buddy first. Whoop. Oh, there's another bow buddy. And they're all breaking my guard and shit. I don't like that. Oh, that's who was shooting me. Guy way up on the battlement there. Nobody likes that. Oh, and here's the fire bomber. Hi. Oh, careless of me, careless indeed. There are, you know, solid strategies for when you should use a life gem and when you should use an Estus based on how quick you need your healing and all that good stuff. To be honest, though, I almost always just use up my Estus first, just because that's going to be replenished for whenever I visit a bonfire, whereas life gems, you have to buy them or find them. Not particularly sound strategically, but it's just the way my mind works. I'm thinking the buckler's gonna be a step down from the Iron Parma, and yep, I am right. It's worse in just about every respect, except a couple of auxiliary defense values, and it's a little lighter. So we'll stick with our Iron Parma for the time being. Still definitely gonna want a better shield as soon as possible. There's nothing else over there, is there? No, I don't think so. Enemy ahead? Well, that describes pretty much the whole damn game, doesn't it? I could go down here and probably come up with some goodies, but I think there's another bonfire up ahead very shortly, so that is going to be my priority for the immediate. Yeah, I'm quite certain there's a dude around the corner here. Yep. Man, I'm missing my backstabs today. Which is surprising, because backstabs, despite the short delay of having to, like, elbow people in the back before you can do the actual move, I find the sweet spot much easier to hit in Dark Souls 2. Witching Urn. We should have a look at that, and have a look at some of our other stuff as well. So, the Witching Urn is over here. It's a firebomb, just with magic damage instead of fire. It is a small clay urn enwreathed in magic. Explodes, inflicting magic damage. Created in Melfia, a land that flourishes with magic and pyromancy. Though the magic contained in the urn lacks potency, it is a boon to any inexperienced traveler. That's some of the other stuff we found. The short sword? Widely used, as it requires no particular strength. A reasonable choice that will suffice in many situations, but not the thing to take along if you expect to face any serious challenge. In other words, it's an early game weapon. Imagine that. And the buckler? Yep, just like in Dark Souls 1, it's easy to parry with. If I were the parrying inclined kind of person, which I'm not. The Hollow Infantry Helm? It's worn and nearly falling apart, not recommended unless your other options are spent. Nothing else of interest here. Yep, same info there. Alright, yeah, nothing exciting happening around here. Like the way this guy fell. You're in timeout! Yeah, someone put a summon sign there, that's kind of an unusual place. We don't really need a buddy right now, though. Now this is a place, at this particular bonfire, that you tend to find lots and lots of summon signs. Yes, it is a comforting spot. And it's a bonfire, which we are definitely going to want to spark up. And here is a valuable new friend for us. Merchant Hag Melentia.
My name is Melentia. You're a stranger to this land. Oh, we get as strangers these days. Everybody's gonna run off. Drang Lake's been a pile of rubble since the war fought long, long ago. When the giants crossed the sea.
Ah, so we get a good explanation at long last for the general state of disrepair we've got around here. Drang Lake's, not looking so good after a war with the giants. And being this is the Forest of Fallen Giants, one may assume they were eventually vanquished, but it was a bit of a Pyrrhic victory. It just, left the kingdom really ravaged, and, yeah, Drang Lake just hasn't had a whole lot of luck recovering from that particular impact.
Seemed like the battles would never end. Poor folk like myself have nary a place to sleep. That's why I keep all me things right with me. You may travel light, but methinks you bear a burden of your own.
Yeah, the dark sign is kind of a bummer. That is a really impressive and rather resourceful rig you've got there, Malentia, but I have to think it's a little rough on the spine, especially at your age.
They say these trees grew from the remains of the giants. From each carcass sprouted new life growing into what you see now. But you know what they also say? Don't believe what an old hag says.
I like Malentia. She's got a little bit of a sense of humor about her. But, yeah, so this literally is the Forest of Fallen Giants. That is to say, where the giants fell, new life grew, just as she says, and this is what we've got.
It's high time that I pick up a moose. Up a bargain for you, next time we meet back up.
And yes, you may recall I mentioned that our hub area, Majula, is much like Firelink Shrine, in that people that we meet in the wild will eventually relocate back there and set up shop in our hub, giving us convenient access to them. Malentia is one of those, but she is not going to move just yet. She's going to stick around right here next to this bonfire until we beat our first boss. So for now, we'll do a little shopping with her, see what she's got to offer. Weapon-wise, nothing too exciting. If you want to do some punchy fisting, there's a Cestus. She's got some traveling merchant gear. We're actually going to want that hat. It is a very good hat, even if it does cover up our leafy greens. Some human effigies, life gems, amber herbs and fire bombs, some more witching urns and throwing knives. Bright bugs. These are real expensive, but they are quite useful as well. As you can see, you inflict more damage and receive less. Pharaoh's Lockstone. She has one of those. We will also want those, because those can be used to activate Pharaoh's contraption, which usually means nifty hidden things. And the Fragrant Branch of Yore, which is what restores living things from petrification. So yeah, you remember that statue back in Things Betwixt? Yep, we do find statues like that here and there, and this is how we can revive them and either interact with the person that was petrified or just get them out of the way. I'll save looking at the flavor text for these until we actually acquire them. And Lenegrast's Key opens Blacksmith Lenegrast's shop in Majula. You may recall that blacksmith we met who was locked out of his shop. Yep, Malentia's got the key for some reason. Key of Blacksmith Lenegrast of Majula. Majula, the land of exiles, is comprised of abandoned old houses, one of which Lenegrast has fashioned into a workshop. So we'll want those so we can get access to our blacksmith. And she's got a few spells here, neither of which is anything we can actually make use of. The basic soul arrow and the basic heal, just like they were in Dark Souls 1. We'll take a closer look at those later when I can afford them. And this hat. Yes, I do want this hat. And I'll show you why. The traveling merchant hat is worn by merchants from Lanifir, where blue represents knowledge. Wearing this increases item discovery. That's what we want. We're gonna want drops. As many drops as we can get. Lanifir is the farthest land to the south and follows a strict edict of isolationism. The rare visitor from Lanifir is always a little odd. So this thing works a lot like a covetous gold serpent ring, just increases your drop rate. And that is a very good thing to have. I'm not crazy about the look of it, and its stats aren't brilliant, but yeah, I want me some of that. You are so welcome. Alright, let's try our new hat. Not great stats, but it's certainly better than nothing. Doesn't add too much weight either. And yeah, it covers up our green, which I'm not delighted with, but at least we get a cool monocle. And look at that. Under our stamina bar, we now have that that serpent up icon, meaning that, yes indeed, we do have increased item discovery. We've got a couple ways we can go here. We can head up the stairs. We can head down the hole here. Or we can go off that cliff over there. Down the hole is actually proper progress, but I'm going to do a little exploring around first, starting with the upstairs here. It's locked, but it looks beat to hell, so let's just smash it. Yep, whenever you hit a door in Dark Souls 2 and it vibrates like that, that means it can actually be beaten down. It's not something the game does a whole lot with, but sometimes it's an option. Wow, I just realized how beat to hell my Morningstar is. Let's use the sword for a while. I think there's a dude in here. Oh, hey, was that a... Thought I might have saw a crystal lizard or something in here. Maybe I did, and just missed it. But yes, it's quite dark in here, as you can see. Scholar of the First Sin does have a somewhat more sophisticated lighting engine than Dark Souls 1, or than vanilla Dark Souls 2. And what that usually means is that dark places are really dark. So torches are actually more useful than they were in the vanilla game, as is the light spell. Just a helmet there. A hand axe. That might be worth checking out. But I'll clear the area first. Chest ahead? Sure is. As I mentioned, wooden chests, you can hit them, but you will sometimes break them, especially if you hit them more than once. And when you're checking for a mimic in this, since the chests don't have chains, you're looking for whether they have visible locks or latches. Ah, some repair powder. As I mentioned, that's very valuable here. So, very good. Be wary of left enemy. Thanks. Oh, yeah. It's a corpse. And if a corpse looks like a regular enemy, that means it is something to be wary of, as I've mentioned before. Ah, the small white sign soapstone. And a few radiant life gems, which is just a step up from the standard life gem. Beware your treasure below. Oh yes, it's just kinda hanging out on the root there. Alright, let's take a look at that new item of ours. Or those multiple new items that we have, rather. First off, the radiant life gems. The dull glimmer of these mysterious stones brightens with the passage of time. So, it looks like they're a little older than the regular life gems, and that makes them more potent. Good to know. And where is that soapstone? Is that in our standard item pile? Where'd they hide it? Oh, here it is. The small white sign soapstone allows you to be summoned as a shade to another world in order to help that world's master for a certain time. You will be rewarded for successfully assisting the other player. The effect is not as long-lived as that of the white sign soapstone, and it is used only in particular places. Now, a few moments to explain how this works. As it explains, this is your item to put down your summon sign and allow other people to summon you into their game for jolly cooperation. However, there are the small white sign soapstone in this game. I can't pronounce that word for love nor money today. And there's the regular one. The small one actually gives you a broader range of people you can connect to. Matchmaking in this game is entirely based on soul memory. Your soul level doesn't actually matter. Let's see here. Soul memory. This is a record of all the souls you have ever gained, whether you've spent them or not. And that is entirely what matchmaking is based on. Pretty controversial decision, doesn't really allow you to do low-level things as long as you've actually continually picked up souls, but that's the way it works. And the small white sign soapstone, I keep saying soapstone, allows you to connect with actually a wider range of soul memory than the standard one. The downside is that it only allows you to be summoned for a short time. It doesn't last all the way into a boss fight like the regular one. Although that can be a positive if you just want to do a short co-op session and try and get yourself revived out of hollowing. Because, yes, successfully assisting another player, be it just for the length of a small summon sign or just for defeating a boss together, that will revive you from hollowed state. Alright, let's see if I can get myself onto this route here and pick up that additional bit of treasure there. And it's a divine blessing. Pretty good stuff for early game. And actually, I think I'm gonna pop my consumables and see if I can pick anything up good from Malentia. Did I look at the repair powder yet? I honestly don't remember. You have only yourself to blame if you find yourself in crisis with no powder to spare. Alright, got a little more solary to spend here, so let's go ahead and do that. I would like to have a couple of fire bombs for a rainy day. I guess that's enough for now. A lot of merchants in this game, if you spend a certain amount with them, they will give you a good customer reward. There's one from Malentia that I'd actually really like to get, but we're going to have to spend some more with her before that happens. Always a pleasure. Now, we've got that key, so what I would like to do now is roll on back and activate the blacksmith shop. Hey, Lenegrast, look what I got.
I'm a blacksmith. I'm nothing without my tools. Bring me that key. Chop, chop.
I've got it right here, dude.
I'm a blacksmith. Bring me...
Oh, that's right. We actually have to unlock the door for him, not give the key to him. I'm a forgetful Jones. And in addition to opening up his shop, we get a chest for our troubles. With a bow in. It's the type of small bow used by hunters in training. You equip arrows to use it, logically enough. And you can equip up to two types of arrows, just as in the previous game. Oh, we're not up to using that, are we? Yes, we need 12 dex, and how much dex do we have? We have a rather meager... Oh, 11 dex, so we're just one short. Alright, well, I'll go ahead and get that point, because we are going to want to have bow access.
Ah, yes, very good. Now I can get to work. But first... Let me set up. Come again later.
And by come again later, he just means go to the bonfire and then come back. So what we will do first is give ourselves a point of dex.
Bearer of the curtain, seek.
Bearer seek, seek lest. And it looks like we will have just enough. Now, we don't actually have any arrows yet, which is going to be a little inconvenient, but we're going to need those dex points ultimately. I think what I'm eventually going to want to have is about 15 dex just to have access to all the weapons that I want to be able to use just for their basic stats, but we are going to be focusing on strength this time out rather than dex, at least for our first playthrough. Like I mentioned, when I get around the new game plus, I think I will very likely respec and try something new. Right, right, we have to do our resting thing. Oddly enough, that provides enough time for Leningrass to get his shop underway.
You, stand back. This is dangerous work. The name's Leningrass. Just a simple blacksmith. And you are... another useless traveler. A man ought to labor with his feet planted firmly in the earth. Not roam around like you flirtatious vagabonds. Oh, what does it matter? Go on, show me what you've got. Your equipment. Let me have a look. But do it quick.
Alright, Leningrass is pretty much your standard Dark Souls-type blacksmith. I'd say he's probably about the equivalent to Andre in this one. Not nearly as pleasant and friendly, but he's very conveniently located. Respectable selection of basic weapon types. No armor, that's what Malin is for here. Some basic projectiles. He has one repair powder and some basic titanite shards. He has only 10 of them. It's going to be quite a while before we have an unlimited access to titanite. Upgrade items are much more carefully gated off in Dark Souls 2, which is both good and bad. Then we've got some wood arrows and some iron arrows and corresponding bolts. I think with the handful of souls I have left, I will pick up just 3? Yeah, that is all I can afford. So, yeah, we'll go ahead and spend the money just to be nice. And we'll have a chat.
Drat. You're worse than my reckless daughter. Don't spend your whole life in transit, you hear?
Hey, dude, I got places to be. And yes, as you may well have guessed, he's mentioned a daughter, so that means we're going to be finding out more about her eventually.
You'll need souls to repair and improve equipment. I know only of smithing, but souls have many other uses as well. Don't waste your souls on useless trinkets. Think before you spend.
Well, it is good advice.
Equipment can be strengthened with rare ore stone, but such ore stone won't come easily. My girl knows her stones, but she's always out prancing about. Now, there's a time for travels, but you can't wander the world forever. Even you must have someone waiting back home.
Well, there was Laurentius, but I'm afraid his time is long, long past.
Drat. You're worse than my reckless daughter. Don't spend your whole...
Okay, looks like Leningrass is starting to repeat himself. He also has a pretty nice frequent customer reward, but we're going to have a good deal more spending money before we can make any use out of that.
I'll be around if you make it back.
Don't sell me short, man. I'll be back many a time. Alright, we can go ahead and put those arrows into our quiver. All 3 of them. And back into the fray. And now we can go to Cardinal Tower, our second bonfire unlocked in the Forest of Fallen Giants. Let's drop some of our respawn enemies out here. Ah, that's the good stuff. And now, once we get rid of this guy, I'm just gonna whack him right off the ladder here. Bonk! Oh, that was awkward. That was even more awkward. Well, that particular die is cast, so, looks like we're going this way. Yuck. That's alright, I wanted to explore this area eventually. If not now, then soon enough. God damn, I gotta get my aim right. Yeah, there's only so much we can do in this area at some point, but there are some fun things to find. Oh, and there's a little shortcut into that area we were before. Now, can I make a jump here? I think maybe I can. Perfect. And it's a human effigy, which is always a good thing to have more of. And although they're nothing interesting yet, we are clearly getting more drops from that hat we've got on. Actually, let's see how this weapon compares to the hand axe. I've been meaning to have a look at that. That actually is more powerful than the Morningstar. Doesn't have the bleed effect. And how's it compare to this? A little better than the sword, too. Yeah, let's put it in this slot. Actually, let's have a look at the moveset and see how it compares. Some nice horizontal swings. That'll make a nice contrast with our Morningstar, so I think I'll go ahead and use that for the time being. Memory serves, there are kind of a lot of hollow dudes in this area, especially down on the forest floor, so not recalling exactly where all of them are, I will proceed with caution. Yep, there's some dudes. Well, let's follow the tree down and plunder some dead dude along the way. We did need some more torch fuel, so that's good. Can I get over to that from here? I'm not entirely sure. But first, let's do away with this guy that's running up the branch at us. Must have caught a look at us in his travels. And there's also clearly another dude there, but I'm gonna wait and see if I can aggro him a little bit later. Yeah, go ahead, take your swing, buddy. Yeah, like I said, definitely a little bit rusty here. Oh well. At least the enemies aren't hitting too hard in this part of the game, so it's not putting me in too much danger just yet. Yeah, let's go ahead and clean out a few more dudes before we try and get a hold of that treasure up top. You're just gonna wander around like a drunk and not actually come at me? Well, if that's the way you want to do it, I'm pretty much okay with that. Guys around here just are not paying attention. Ooh. You see that dude with the big shell back there? Looks kind of like a turtle with a big hammer. Yeah, that's someone to be fairly careful of this early in the game. That is an ironclad. And they're not hugely problematic enemies, but at this point in the game, when I'm really still kind of weak, they can kind of tear my shit up, and blocking against them doesn't work real well. Well, let's go ahead and get his attention. Oh, and by the way, because of that big shell, there will be no backstabbing this guy. Hi. Oh yeah, you don't even have to try and backstab them, they can just fall right on you. Kinda forgot about that. Well, we certainly got his attention now. unfortunately. Being big guys in huge armor, they are well on the slow side. Oh god! And they have a four-hit combo, as you can see. But surprisingly, for as well armored as they are, they do not have a whole lot of HP or defense. So at least they drop without too much provocation. Now, I'm not gonna let you fall on me like the last guy did. We're just gonna get your attention a little more carefully and bring you out into the open for a good fight. They do have that one four-hit combo, but you can kind of tell when that's coming out because it starts with a fast swing. Any slow swings they do, they're just going to do a single attack on you, fortunately. So you can deal with those guys with relative caution. Is there anything good in here? A little bit of treasure. Foot soldier shield, which I don't think is anything exciting compared to what we already have. So many of the hollows around here just don't seem to be paying much attention. We'll see the other side of this fiery barricade eventually. We can't go through from this direction. Well, we do find some free life gems nearby, and free is my favorite kind of life gem. I think going up this way just gets us back out. Is that correct? That is more or less correct. Yeah, that puts us back where we were, so I'm gonna see if I can make that jump, get that other goodie back there. We'll go ahead and jump this way again. Even if it's not strictly necessary, I do like to practice my jumping, because it never gets easy in this game. And yeah, I think we're gonna have to make a big old leap in order to get that treasure there. Try jumping and then treasure! Thank you for confirming my suspicions. Kabong! Perfect. And just some prism stones, which you may recall are just things you can drop to mark your path. Emits a beautiful phasing aura of seven colors with a very rare eighths. The Prism Stone does nothing special, but if you feel you may lose your way, it can serve you as a path marker. Being kind of smooth and silky, it's also a thing that you can trade to Dinah and Tillo, but it is the lowest tier trading item, so chances are you will not get something very good for it. Thanks, message. Alright, nothing else I can do right here, I believe. Well, we can check out this fiery cave, which is a risky place, but there is treasure to be had. And are there duders who are going to drop in on me? I seem to vaguely recall that, but that may be a vanilla Dark Souls 2 thing. They may not actually be there in Scholar. Okay, that is why this path is risky. There is a salamander back there, which is going to try and set us on fire. By the way, as you can see, these little fires on the ground are nothing that will hurt us, so we've at least got that going for us. This guy can't really fire too readily around the corner, so that helps us out. Soul of a Proud Knight, this early in the game, is a very nice consumable. So between fire bursts, we're going to want to try and open this door and get our asses through. Saved by the opening animation. And our nifty reward here is a fire longsword, which is not quite as good on the scaling as a regular longsword, but it does come with fire damage. So let's see, what'll be best to replace with that? Strength scaling is not as good as our current weapons. Let's put it in place of the axe. And since that's our first longsword, we'll take a quick look at it. This straight sword is sufficient in most respects, and effective in most situations if wielded properly. Those who aspire to master the sword are certain to wield this at some point during their journey. And you know what? We've cleared this area out pretty well. I think I'm just gonna zoom right on back to the bonfire. Homeward Bone style. We'll re-kill a few enemies out here just for the souls. Actually, let's set this guy on fire. Satisfying. Alright. Let me pop my fresh consumables and we'll see if that gives us enough money to buy any of Malentia's better goodies, and if it doesn't, we can always just spend it back in Majula.
You again?
Well, yeah, you're gonna be seeing a lot of me. The other merchant gear we don't really need. Oh, hey, but we have enough for the lockstone. That's a positive. Yoink! And this is a stone activating a creation of Pharos the Vagabond. Pharos the Vagabond was a legend who wandered the lands, creating contraptions to help those in sincere and dire need. The scope of his travels was so wide that Pharos has been mistakenly credited with many inventions that were crafted by others. So, a sort of traveling inventor, and we will find various devices that he's left scattered throughout the land, and we will need these lock stones in order to activate them. Some of them are kind of worthless, but this is usually very much worth doing. Okay, we're still gonna need to do some more spending with Malentia before she gives us our prize, but that's okay. Hey, all rested up. We will kill this guy one more time for good measure. See if I can get the sword backstab on him. Quit turning so fast. There we go. Not really even a stab per se, we're just gonna carve him up from the rear. Free firebomb, best firebomb. And we've been here for a while, I think we're gonna call it a day soon, but we can at least start exploring down the hole here, which is our next proper direction for progress. Now there ought to be a dude coming across the bridge here, indeed there is. These halberd guys usually do a 3-hit combo. That's pretty much their standard collection of attacks right there. Oh, wasn't watching my stamina. And this guy usually doesn't wake up until you get much closer, but this time he did. Whatever. Ah, more free firebombs. Hooray for that. This door I believe we will have to open from the other side, indeed. And down here we have a fire pit with some more of those salamanders. We don't really have a good way of getting down here just yet, and even if we did, tangling ass with those guys might not be the best idea in the world, so we'll just save that one for future reference. Over this away, there's just a bit more treasure and a conspicuous standard enemy model corpse. You know what that means. This is another door we can't get through right now. Made out of wood, but it doesn't vibrate, so we cannot smash it. More consumables. Always welcome. Thanks, message. Always nice to get a little encouragement in these parts. Here's another Yeah, this guy's even moving. He's not even trying. Now this door, is this a smashable? I think it might be a smashable. Nope, I'm wrong. Okay. On the bright side, sconce! Blaze it all day, every day. That's how we do. And we can continue on through a fog gate there, which will expose us to more of the Forest of Fallen Giants, but I think that will be something for another day. For now, let's just have a nice rest. Get our equipment and health and Estus back in tip-top shape. And that will do it. It's very good to be back and to see you all again. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you real soon for more I Played a Thing, Dark Souls 2, Scholar of the First Sin, and more of the Forest of Fallen Giants. Until then, this is Un. Take care. Hey, you got in the way of my bow there. Ghost dude. There we go. This episode of I Played a Thing has been brought to you by such generous supporters as Justin Carpenter, Nolden, Zangamarth, Charlie Dunst, Anonymous Benefactor, John Madigan, Johnny Millennium, Sanguine Games, Joseph Coco, Misha Van Doren, Craig Patterson, Frank Grizzy, Tim J, Lolo DePuzzlo, Joshua C. Ritchie, Jared C. Rice, Darren Chow, Sonic Rose, and EX Potemkin. Thank you all very much, and thank you very much to all patrons, watchers, subscribers, commenters, all you good folks. Glad to have you along, and I'll see you again real soon.